So my kids ruined me, and I think it backfired because I ruined them, okay, in my own unique way. That's what parents do. And so for the last few years, they've been telling me, Mommy, you're 40. Mommy, you're 40. So I started believing it. So when last week somebody asked me, Nanny, how old are you? I'm 40. I'm not 40. I still have a few years till I get there. I'm getting closer. So my sister-in-law in America told me, Nanny, when you hit the age of 40, something just switches in your body, and little hairs start growing on your body in places you don't wanna. So I must mature very fast because my little mustache has been growing since a very young age. I knew there's wisdom in my eyes, but there's somehow on my upper mustache area. So I decided, my husband doesn't have a mustache. I don't want to be the only manly person in the house. So I don't want to look more manly than my husband, and he doesn't even have hair here. So it's like, I need to keep up with my husband. So I go and I buy these little band-aids, wax band-aids. Are you familiar? Ouch! You know what I'm talking about. So I decide, okay, I'm gonna do this. So I go, I feel the band-aid, you know how it goes. You already feel the pain and you're like, it's coming, it's coming. I press it nice on one side, left side, pack, right? You want to get them all to the middle. So you pack, you pull, you scream a little, right? We like to be dramatic. Express our pain, it's our gift. To be historical and hysterical, that's what my husband says. And then we go to counseling from time to time. Because of him, you know. Well, after you pull a mustache, you got good counseling, pain management. So I go to the right side, I peel, I put it on, I press nicely, I do this, and then of course I say what?
Ouch!
It's so painful. So after I say ouch, now I do this. I want it to look very fresh. Did I mention I did this on a Sunday morning? Tomorrow morning. And please don't look at your neighbor if they have a mustache right now. It's awkward. Do it afterwards when people are praying. You're kind of like, oh, she did it recently. Starting to grow. It might have been 2 weeks ago. And now, what I forgot to tell you, although my face looked like better than the wildfires of California, if you know what I mean, it looked like I had a permanent red marker on my face. And there was no lotion, no baby powder, nothing would help. Now, did I forget to mention also that I was due to play worship and I had to play the piano in front of human beings, some with a mustache, some without the mustache, nobody like mine. So here I am, I think, okay, my daddy taught me to be creative. There's always a way out. We live in communism, we're poor. We always think outside the box. So Nanny has to think outside the box. I should have stayed in a box. So here I go, I look in the mirror, I gotta be creative. I didn't have kids to give me ideas, so I'm like, okay, I need to think. So I think, if I smile, the crease kind of covers it. So you already know me, that when I sleep, I smile. So apparently I'm the smiley all the time. This time I'm gonna double the dose. It's not creepy to go like, you know, to church like this. It's not creepy at all. So I don't know how many of you watch Old Dogs, the movie. You know John Travolta? He's already got that largish smile. Now he swaps medicine by mistake, and as a side effect, he's got this tremendously large mouth. It's like smiling and people are crying. It's like, yeah, I know, but just a side effect. So I have side effects a lot, but more intensely on that day. So it's Sunday morning, I smile. I play the piano and I just smile and I'm creepy, but I smile. I'm the pastor's wife, I can get away with things. Holier than thou, here I go. After the church, I go in, we go with friends. A husband and a wife, and they were doctors. I needed one. So they must have sensed, we need to go to lunch with them. So I go, and I smile. And my friend is asking, are you okay? Of course. Told you Christians lie. She didn't, well, she knew it. Nadia, are you okay? Why are you asking? You look strange. Oh, really? I didn't notice. But I didn't look in the mirror after I started smiling. No, my husband loves me so much, he never questioned anything. But then I have other stories of an embarrassment like that where I eat actually something roasted, what do you call them, corn. And I hit them all over my face. And I invite, it was at the church retreat, and the whole church came, and I'm like the welcoming person. Hi, hi! I had this gunk all over my face. He loved me in spite of it. But he didn't tell me. So don't you love friends like this, where they tell you, you got spinach in your teeth, you're dragging toilet paper? I better check, because I was jogging on my way to Germany at the airport. I had toilet paper. I wasn't sure if Ray had good toilet paper, so I was bringing my own. So it's good to have friends like this. And so in the end, my friend's like, Nadia, are you okay? My muscles relax. I'm like, so glad you asked. It's so exhausting to smile heavily. It's good to have friends like that. But one lesson I learned. Behind each smile, a mustache hides. It's a deep theological issue, I guess. You're smiling. Are you hiding your mustaches? Behind each smile, a mustache story hides. We're trying to hide something that we just peeled off and looks fresh and raw. Maybe it's by... Not necessarily we're trying to hide it. Maybe we just feel uncomfortable talking about it. Maybe it's something shameful that you did or something that others did to you. Maybe it's a raw pain. Maybe it's something that you're grieving and you're even having a hard time to talk about. Behind each smile, a mustache story hides an ouch moment that it's a lot deeper and he has wounds. Today I want for us to again go to the scripture and learn from there. So let's pray. Dear Jesus, on our own we only have foolish stuff, but in your word we find power, we have strength, we find healing in your name. So I pray that you'd come in right now and just teach us from your word. Convict us where we need to be convicted. Lift us those that need to be lifted up. We love you, Jesus, but we thank you for first loving us. Thank you for your word. Amen. So we're going to look right now at 1 Kings. We're going to talk about Elijah. Elijah's tagline would be like, I'm fine, but actually I'm not. I don't think he has a mustache story, but he's got the story. So we meet Elijah in 1 Kings chapter 17. So I'm going to give you the background. Remember, we talked about the fact that we had King Saul. Then we had King David, and then we had Solomon. And then Rehoboam and Jeroboam, they split the kingdom. So we have after this, 20 in the northern part, we have, I kind of spelled it out. How many kings? Work with me, pretend. 20, right? And in the southern one, we have how many? 20. Now we remember that Hezekiah, he was in which part? In the southern part. And now today we're going to talk about the fact that, what's his name? Elijah. He works with the king, where he's in the same time with the king, but from the northern part, from Israel. And this king's name is Ahab. Now, are you familiar with Ahab and Jezebel? They kind of go together. Misery likes company, but so does craziness. So Ahab and Jezebel are in this time, so don't confuse him with Ahaz, which is Hezekiah's daddy. They have similar names. So we're going to talk about the northern part right now, and that's where the prophet Elijah is. And in chapter 17...
18.
Sorry?
Chapter 18.
Don't interrupt me. In chapter 18, yes. I was just checking if you know. good here. In chapter 17, and I was going so strong. Almost, in my head only. So, there is this bad news that Elijah has to give to a bad king. What do you think happens?
No rain for 3 years.
Yes. He becomes the target. He turns to be on the wanted list. He wants him dead, kaput. So what he does, he becomes pretty much a refugee. He's on the run for his life. He experiences famine, he experiences death, he experiences fear for his life for 3 years. But then in chapter 18, Nonia, 3 years later, Elijah has a rendezvous, a meeting with the king. And all the killers are invited. Come on Mount Carmel and let's have a meeting. Bring your 450 prophets of Baal, bring them up, let them have their sacrifice, and don't match the light, don't do that, don't light the fire, let your God do it, and let's see who's the real God. So they slash themselves, it's cruel what he gets to see, they dance, they shout, they are crazy, nothing happens. Then it's Elijah's turn to prove that he serves the right God, so he puts his sacrifice, he even pours water, so much water, 3 times, and then God does the miracle, and people praise the Lord. And the 450 prophets of Baal are annihilated. Mission accomplished, heroic movement, victory is God's. I love what happens in 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 42. It's very interesting. So Ahab went off to eat and drink, but Elijah climbed to the top of Mount Carmel, bent down to the ground, and put his face between his knees. Now, isn't that an interesting? What happened? Who is in fetal position, and who is going to celebrate? Who is with head between his knees, on the ground, on the bathroom floor, and who is going and eating and drinking? Doesn't that strike you funny? Sometimes people like to see, or we even want for people to see us on mountaintops, victorious, right? That's what we post on Facebook and Instagram. We don't post to them when we stay on the bathroom floor. I don't. My friend, you're okay. Even if you're going and you're having these bathroom floor moments, you're still among the saints. You're still among the saints. And Satan will tell you, you lost your faith. You're not one of his. That's a lie. You're still among the saints. Elijah struggled, and he saw miracles upon miracles. And James, when he talks about prayer, the prayer of a righteous person is powerful. He talks about this Elijah that right now is having a low moment, a bathroom floor moment. Moses, in Numbers 11, 14, he tells God, I cannot carry all these people by myself. The burden is too heavy for me. Please go ahead and kill me. Did you know Moses said that? Now, the one that shocked me the most is Jesus' cousin. Matthew 11, 2 and 3. When John, who was in prison, right, he hit his own moment, heard about the deeds of the Messiah, he sent his disciple to ask, are you the one who is to come, or should we expect someone else? John the Baptist was questioning Jesus' identity. You're still among the saints. How many of you have heard of America's Got Talent? Yeah? Nightbird is the name stage of a Liberty grad. She went and sang there a beautiful original song, It's Okay, when she wasn't okay. And she even got the buzzer from Simon. Who likes Simon? Are you guys married? Shouldn't be raising that hand. So this is what Nightbird, the singer, says. After the doctor told me I was dying, and after the man I married said he did not love me anymore, on those nights I could not sleep. I laid in the tub like an insect. The bathroom floor became my place to hide, where I could scream and be ugly. I have had cancer 3 times now, and I have barely passed 30. I am God's downstairs neighbor, banging on the ceiling with a broomstick. I show up at his door every day, sometimes with songs, sometimes with curses, sometimes apologies, gifts, questions, and demands. Call me bitter if you want to. That's fair. But count me also among the friends of God. She actually passed. She went to be with Jesus the first Sunday of the Ukrainian war. She's not fighting no more. She's rejoicing in heaven. So my friend, first of all, I want you to know that no matter what is your struggle, whatever is the shame, the pain, the grieving you're going through, you know it. But you're still among the saints of God. You're okay. We just need to persevere in the resources God gave us. We might go through tunnels, we just cannot park there. We might go through bathroom floor moments, we just cannot stay stuck there. We gotta get moving. And so did they. So this is what happens. At this point, Jezebel, he's already feeling low, and when blows come, they come many at the same time. So Jezebel says, I'm gonna kill you. Not in so many words, but yeah, I'm gonna kill you. So he's even more scared for his life. So he has 3 responses. Look at 1 Kings 19, verse 3. Elijah was afraid and ran for his life. When he came to Beersheba in Judah, he left his servant there. I want for me to just point out 3 responses that he had, Elijah. But I don't want to stay and spend too much time on the response Elijah had, because we know how we respond to pain and to fear. So I want to focus mainly on how God responded. But he did go and run, and don't we run? We leave people behind. He left his servant in Beersheba. We push people out. C.S. Lewis wrote once, I had always been more anxious to avoid suffering than to achieve delight. We want God to get rid of this. I don't like this. Rather than persevere and fight for the birthright of joy. Joy is a birthright in Christ. Elijah's second response was to hide. Verse 4, while he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness. Wilderness, no people, no food, no resources to get better. It's putting your blanket up your head and be done with it all. Elijah's third response was to collapse. Verse 4, the second part of it. He came to a broom bush, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. Some prayers don't really honor God. I have had enough, Lord, but he's honest. Take my life, I'm no better than my ancestors. It sounds like Moses, doesn't it? So let's look at God's response. That's more interesting. So look in chapter 19, verses 5 to 8. Then Elijah lay down under the bush and fell asleep. All at once an angel touched him and said, get up and eat. He looked around, and there by his head was some bread baked over hot coals and a jar of water. He ate and drank, and then lay down again. The angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you. So he got up, ate, and drank. It's interesting. I expected God to give a little sermonette, a little pep talk, mind no better. There's no pep talk. It's body stewardship. Have a little nap. Actually, good sleep. Have some carbs. Okay, ice cream, chocolate.
Spaghetti.
A very carby seminar, by the way. And stay hydrated. And it's not like once was sufficient. Sometimes the weariness of that refugee life, it's just the season was so long that he needed to do that a little longer. So the angel allowed him to do it twice. So So body stewardship. So I'm very good at fake resting. Are you good at that? I like to do fake resting. So in present over perfect, the author talks about that. Sometimes fake resting is when the rest of your family is watching TV, doing puzzles, relaxing. You almost look like you're doing the same thing. You have coffee in your hand, you're in your PJs, but all you're doing is I'm ticking down an endless list. Sometimes written, always mental. Don't we do that? Getting things back into the right spot, changing the laundry, wiping down the countertops. I fake rested instead of real rested, and then I was real tired. And we expect to be okay. So I told you, I'm learning to leave things undone, even if my purse and my home looks like a little bit like a Saturday garage sale. Now, when I don't want to stop, God puts some breaks sometimes in our life. So I like what George Mueller said. God not only orders our steps, he also orders our stops. When we don't want to voluntarily stop, he does it for us. In 2016, that's what happened with us. My husband had a severe heart attack because we were just going and going, and he said, stop, reevaluate, prioritize. And we paused. And it was a good pause because my husband started just, his white knuckles kind of, he just let go of control. And we started prioritizing our family time and just being in the moment, enjoying each other right now. Another thing that is helpful when it comes to body stewardship is acknowledging your limitations. This afternoon I was really enjoying and was really excited to go to that Carvey seminar that Andrea had and to the hermeneutics seminar just to see a little bit kind of the flavors of the seminars. And then suddenly a really strong headache came, so I decided, do I push through, because that's normal for me, just to push through. And I said, I'm going to teach on this, so I better practice it. So I took some Tylenol and I just laid down. I traveled with the teddy bear, so my teddy bear was right next to me. And then we have physical limitations, and it's okay to acknowledge sometimes I just need to stop, even if some people might get disappointed. You okay, Andrea, though? I can watch it later.
You're good.
Okay. And then another thing that's interesting concerning body stewardship is that sometimes your trauma, there's also trauma stewardship. You're a caretaker. Maybe you're not the patient, but you have aged parents. You have some handicap or some other struggles in the family. I'm a caretaker for my daughter with diabetes, so my rest is very disruptive when I have to go and check sugar, feed her in the middle of the night, give a little extra insulin if the hormones go up and down. If my husband gets up because his heart is palpitating, apart from smiling at his pain, I also have to help him out. Trauma stewardship. So, but Jesus showed us how to handle trauma stewardship. Mark 6:31, then because so many people were coming and going, as they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest. He's telling that to his disciples. So come with me on the boat. Sometimes you have to let the trauma be trauma. It's going to be there when you return. And sometimes because these family members that need us, you can't just let them be sometimes. So you might need to ask for help from somebody in your church. That's why it's important to be in the community of church so you can have those resources. Have your tribe and they'll have your back. But if you stay at home, the TV won't come and help you. Mark 5:18-19. As Jesus was getting into the boat, the man who had been demon-possessed begged to go with him. Jesus had just healed this man. And this man wants to come with Jesus. He was so excited. And you'd expect Jesus is a kind man. Of course, he'll say yes. And Jesus did not let him, but said, go home to your own people. Are you by default set on yesing people? I like to yes people. that instead of being like the TV, you know, when it's got that light, you know, it's on all the time, a little red light, I'm just always plugged in. Sometimes we need to unplug. And I read this somewhere that it's good. It may sound very offensive to some people, but it's good to define the circles, create the circles of the people you're okay to disappoint sometimes. Create your core group. I cannot disappoint these. It's my family. My immediate family were really close friends. So these, I will try my very best to always say yes as much as I can. But then I have these people where most of the time, well, as much as I can, I will say yes. But then I have this larger group here. You know what? Even Jesus said no. And even he escaped with the boat. So it's okay. Hopefully they're in someone else's core group. But it's okay to prioritize who you're okay to disappoint. Because you cannot keep it up. Sometimes you need to unplug that TV. So we know that first is body stewardship. The second one is moving is life. The doctor told my father after he had the transplant, you got to always stay moving. Passeggiata, passeggiata. Yeah, walk, walk. Moving is life. So I know I've been saying about Mary Poppins here, but her name is Carol. She's got a real name. And she came from the States for 6 weeks to serve the refugees, to help our family. Now her story goes a little deeper. A few years ago, she lost her home completely in the Harvey hurricane. Completely gone. Not long after that, she lost her husband to cancer. And not long after that, she lost her mom. Grieving, a lot of mourning, a lot of loss. And you may identify with that. And instead of staying stuck at home in a pity party, apart from the fact that she jumps out of airplanes, and that's a little crazy. That's why she can fly. I told you she's Mary Poppins. She can fly, literally. She decided to not stay at home and just have a pity party. Although, it's kind of understandable. It's hard. But she decided to stay moving. Go serve. Go do something. Focus on others. And let God do the healing. Moving is life. Look at 1 Kings 19:8b. 8b is in the sense that is the second part of the verse. Strengthened by that food, he traveled 40 days and 40 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. God wanted him out of the pity party place, the shrub, the broom bush. Now, when I hit depression a few years ago because of the side effects of medication, I called Gigi Sandy, who did the seminar on prayer, and I called her. I knew that she struggled at one point with depression. Is that okay to share that? I shared with her what's going on. She said this, Natty, when I dealt with that, and now I have permission to share that. She said, I always got out of bed, literally, make a physical statement. I'm out of bed. I make the bed and I drink a glass of water. That's my routine. Just make a statement to the devil. I'm not staying in. So I started doing that, and I got into that habit all the time, and it helped me to stay moving. But to the point that if it's a bit early in the morning and I go and I, you know, my husband goes to the bathroom and when he comes back, the bed is made. I make a statement, honey, you need to get up. I took it to the extra mile. My friend, as we drive through tunnels, don't stay there. Don't park there. It's dangerous. Make a statement, make your bed, drink your water. Make sure nobody's sleeping in that bed while you make the bed. That might suffocate them. God's response, number one, was what? Body stewardship. You got it, girls? Almost. Number two?
Moving is life.
Moving is life. Number three, look at 1 Kings 19:9. There he went into a cave and spent the night, and the word of the Lord came to him. What are you doing here, Elijah? It's time for God to speak. The mind of God. Now he hears the thoughts of God. Are you daily, hearing from the word of God? Now, are you eating daily? Are you showering, brushing your teeth daily? What are the things that you do daily? Phoning daily? Why do we find it so hard to be in His Word daily? Now, there's this concept that I have heard of. For those people that use the phone a lot, they call them, you know, where that's their life, their social life, their work, their everything. They call them residents. It's just a term they use. And for those people that use the phone, but only as necessary, as a tool, and then they put it away, they're not addicted to it, they call them visitors. It's just a term they use. My friend, are you a visitor or a resident of the Bible? Are you a visitor or a resident of the Bible? Do you from time to time, you know, you hear the scripture in church, so that's good enough? That's visiting. Maybe a verse popped, the verse of the day popped on your phone and you're happy with it. Ooh, that fits me today. And that's enough. That's called a visitor. Or are you residing in that? Now, it's very good to create the habit. When I was 11, I found a book in the house and it said 5 minutes with Jesus. So I decided I'll do that. So before school, I always read that little devotional book and it created the habit. I love devotional books for that reason. So I thought, okay, when I grow up, I'll write the devotional book. A few years ago, I realized, I'm tired of chewing someone else's gum. It's their thoughts. They chew the scripture in their own unique way, how God spoke to them, and I get to eat that. I get to be enjoying that. I'm tired of chewing someone else's gum. So I decided, okay, even with the women's ministry in our church, when somebody asked me, so Nadia, at your church, what are some books that you guys do, Beth Moore or other people? What studies? I said, we do the Bible. Try it. It's good. That's my thing. And from now on, that's the book we're going to do in that church. I'm tired of reading other people's books. They're great, as you know, vitamin D, zinc, whatever we take nowadays. That's good, but that's not my meal. That's bonus. Yeah. But devotional book is not my reading. That's not scripture. I'm sorry, ladies. I'm a little harsh. I'm cute, but harsh. One time in a car ride, you have great conversation. Somebody asked me, Natty, what would make your day complete? And I said, making laundry. Having my laundry all done and then reading the Bible. And I kind of just said it like that, but they had no idea how much it meant. My best day, no matter how many hours I sleep or nap that night, if I wake up at 5 a.m. and stay in the scripture for 2-3 hours, I'm so excited. I have kids, so I have to kind of stop, cut it off. But I get so energized. The Bible is so fascinating, it's not even funny. Actually, it's funny, it's got some really funny parts. I have my alarm on my phone. It says, wake up before the world needs me. Wake up before the world needs me. Now, when you read the Bible, there's different ways of doing it. And whoever went to the seminar, you've learned some skills I can take home. There's also the raking. You know, if you're a farmer, you know what raking is. When you take the leaves out. Raking the Bible is like reading it like a novel and trying to just see the layout of the Bible, raking the Bible. But then there is digging in the Bible when you focus more on a specific verse and you dig and you try to see what treasure, what does it mean in other translations, in Greek. So that's digging. But however you do it, just read one chapter a day. Start, whenever I read the Bible, I read from Genesis to Revelation. When I get to that end of the book, I start Genesis to Revelation. That's how my life looks like. On a gym billboard, it said that 1 hour of workout, that's 4% of your day. But what if you did only 4 minutes a day? You could read the whole Bible in 3 years. And that's a reasonable pace, honestly. It's almost like reading one chapter a day. That's what we do in Bucharest. We read with the ladies one chapter a day at home, and on Thursday we meet and we talk about different fascinating things that we studied on our own. I don't need to buy extra books on Amazon that don't show up in Romania. I got my Bible. Create the joy. The reason we think Bible is boring is because we kind of got used to it's boring. Create the joy. Get excited about it. Get creative. Play the detective. Try to figure out who killed who and how, and create charts, maps. Google it. Doodle it. I cannot read my Bible without my Crayola in my hand and without my little notebook. And the Bible gives us this freedom to be creative. We're creative in so many ways, but when it comes to the Bible, it's just boredom. In Deuteronomy 11, 18 to 20, it says, "Fix these words of mine in your hearts and minds. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Teach them to your children, talking about them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, when you get up. Write them on your door frames of your houses and on your gates." Go to the next few pictures. So this is how our doodling looks like with my kids, because I teach them that it's not just about reading. We're having so much fun with the girls. This is my favorite time of the day. We go and we draw and then we write the lesson. You can keep going. And this is the God's Temple by Solomon. And they understand a little bit better. We're not great at art, but it still keep on going. And they decided, let's do a VBS theme with David's sons. So one is Baby Yoda, of course. Keep on going. And then we do charts with the kids. And even in my own personal journal, we do charts. Why? Because that's how it makes sense. Do that. Why wouldn't we? An architect told me in Bucharest, "I never thought I could do that. I made drawings for buildings. Why couldn't I make drawings for the Bible?" Do we have more? Oh yeah, I'm cute here. So now you can see my kids are taller, but that was even a year ago. This is more about how we started to, even in our quiet time, we sing verses. And then because we started doing it on our own, we decided, let's share it with others. So we did a YouTube channel. So feel free to, and this was free advertising, to join. Hazael, king over Aram, also anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, king over Israel, and anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, from Abel Meholah to succeed you as a prophet. Jehu will put to death, and who escaped the sword of Hazael, and Elisha will put to death any who escaped the sword of Jehu. Yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, and all those whose knees have not bowed down to Baal, and whose mouths have not kissed him. Now Elijah thought he was alone. "I am the only one, and I was zealous for you." But when we're depressed, the realities are skewed, are not true. So he thinks he's alone, but he's not. He just didn't pray for community. And now he's real with God. He tells him, "I was alone, do something about it." He brings it to prayer, and God brings him, 7,000 people, plus leaders on top of it. Okay, I got you covered. So it's important for us to have the hands of God, the community of God. So when we go to church, and I hope you are attending church regularly, because that's how God intended it to be, and for us not to forget the meetings. So sometimes when we go to church, we have this Goldilocks syndrome. The music is too loud, the sermon is too long, and the chairs are too hard. Sounds familiar? We have that Goldilocks syndrome. When you see a problem in your church, make sure you volunteer for it. That's your first clue, or maybe you'll stop. As Christian, we have so accustomed to do these three things: complain, criticize, and correct. Mainly the pastor. So I look at Hebrews Hebrews chapter 13, verse 17, there's no slide. Have confidence. There's one. Hey, I'm smart. Have confidence in your leaders and submit to their authority, because they keep watch over you as those who must give an account. Do this so that their work will be a joy, not a burden, for that would be of no benefit to you. Don't be difficult on your pastors. I'm a pastor's wife, and I'm telling you, there is some pressure there. Try to be a joy. I'm not saying pastors are perfect, but they carry a lot. And do, if you have a pastor's wife here, check on her. Minister to her. Pray for her. Are you, if you're attending church, I had a friend in Moldova, and she was going regularly to church, as Christians should, and then a farmer came to my friend and said, I see your family coming to church, and that's good. You take in the worship, you guys listen to the sermon. You look like you're a consumer, but you're never a producer in that church. You consume all the goodies, but you never do anything. You don't never give anything. So try to think about that. Am I only a consumer in that church, or am I also a producer? We need to become a very magnetic church, but when each one of us needs to do our part in the church. It's not always on the elders or the pastor. When you go to church, don't go selfishly just for your benefit. Go for the benefit of others. Even if your ministry is nothing but sitting next to someone that you're going to encourage. Maybe that's your ministry. Go for the benefit of others, not only your own. You have only one chance to make a good impression. And we've had so many people come to our church. And I remember one time Cammie said, she shared with me her story that when she came to our church, she found it on Facebook, and she said, this is the last time I'm going to give a try to a church. I had no idea. So somehow we connected, and she started coming and getting involved in church. But sometimes we make a poor impression because we're not very welcoming. We just stay in our little clan, in our little group. Notice the new people. Notice those that stay lonely somewhere. Sit in a new place. Don't carve your name at the back with chewing gum. And be careful with words. Words don't come without autocorrect like my phone does. They don't come. So be careful, because we wound people. And Graham Lutz wrote the book, Wounded by God's People. I read it. It's a really good book. Wounded by God's people. And there's three responses usually. Some people, when they get wounded, they leave the church. And I've met so many. The second response I see, they wound back. Wounded people, they wound others. So be careful not to do that. The third type of people that I saw is that they realize it was just a productive struggle. See it for what it is. God puts in us, in our life, my friend Lydia once said, holy sandpaper people. They're like a little holy sandpaper. So see the massage that you're growing through that. So don't be offended by that. I know each one of us is going through a lot of struggles, like Elijah. And we saw how God dealt with Elijah. Nightbird, the singer that passed, said this, when it comes to pain, God isn't often in the business of taking it away. Instead, he adds to it. He is more of a giver than a taker. He does not take away my darkness. He adds light. He doesn't spare me from thirst. He brings water. He does not cure me of loneliness. He comes near me. So why do we believe that when we are in pain, it must mean that God is far? He's a giver more than a taker. My friend, maybe you are on the bathroom floor even right now. You're still among the saints. Don't doubt in the dark what God has shown you in the light. C.S. Lewis said this, God allowed our life to be less agreeable so we don't have a false sense of happiness. So we don't have a false sense of happiness that my phone gives me happiness, that my clothes give me happiness, that it's my family that gives me happiness. In spite of not having family, in spite of not having technology, in spite of losing a home, a son, a daughter, in spite of that, that is joy. That is God-given joy. Joy is our birthright as a Christian. Fight for it, my friend. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer, Romans 12:12. You should really subscribe. And just, I really killed my moment of seriousness. My friend living in Bucharest has sprained her ankle. And after my friend sprained her ankle, she had to go to do physiotherapy. And she came on Thursday morning to our Bible study group and she said, "Natty, healing is painful. Healing is painful. But God can do it." I want for us right now to listen to our song, just to reflect, and then we'll guide you guys on what's next.
Lie number two, everybody's life is perfect except yours.
this weekend, you'll go with at least one thing, one radical change in your life. It's about time to be done snoozing and napping as a Christian. I hope you at least you will chalk that circle and say, Lord, bring revival in this circle of mine, because I cannot expect my spouse, my kids, my neighbor, my sibling, my whoever to know you, or I cannot have inescapable influence unless change starts right here. So I want for us to take this time. I loved hearing the joyful noise. You guys are loud people, and I loved it. But it's about time sometimes to be silent. When God showed or spoke, revealed himself to Elijah, first time there was an earthquake, and then there was wind, and then there was fire, but God was not in that. He was not in the big noise. He was not in the fireworks. He was in the gentle whisper. So today we're going to do some gentle whispering. So I want Nuna, if you can put some music in the background. Maybe you didn't count on suffering. There's a song. We didn't count on pain, but if the blessings in the valley, in the river, I will stay. So I want for you right now, you received a little envelope on your plate. I want for you to write a letter to yourself of commitment that you mean it while it's still fresh in your heart. Whatever we talked session one when I was going like a rabbit very fast. If you got anything out of that, write it down. If not, move on to the next two. And if anyone, maybe if they don't have the paper or something is missing, you need one, please let us know and Jackie can bring you one. But what I want you to do is to take that and write yourself a commitment letter, something you radically want to change, genuinely you want to change in your life. Maybe it's about the talents. Maybe you only have ingredients right now and there's no food. Maybe it's something of reading your Bible daily, and I mean it daily, and I mean the Bible, not your devotional book. Sometimes truth is offensive. You're welcome. But it's the scripture. Revival, I want revival in your heart, in my heart, that lasts beyond the week and the fun. It was amazing to see and to hear you guys sing at the fireplace. It's fun while it lasts, but we need to make decisions right now. We should write down, write something. But what I did tell you is that on the envelope, I want you to write your address. Maybe your bank account, too. Maybe not. Your address that you will still have available in a month or two, because these letters will be sealed and you're going to bring it right here and you'll receive it in the mail, because I'm afraid you'll misplace it by own purpose or by mistake. They will be seeing it ready. So I want you to bring it right here in a little bit. And they should come, after you're done, just take your time to pray. Pray for whatever you need. And I will ask in a little bit to have all the seminar speakers here available to pray with you. Whatever it is. I want for us to take it this seriously, this God thing seriously. Jesus took it enough seriously that he even died on the cross for us. He deserves our attention. He deserves our life. So I want you to take this time and I will shut up. Promise. So take this time to write a commitment letter to yourself, and then please address it with your address where you will be found. Please don't write it to your cousin, the address of someone else that needs to hear your commitment letter. Finish writing this letter. Whenever you're ready, there's no pressure, but whenever you're ready, feel free to come and take this little cross as a reminder. I put mine on my backpack. Wherever I go, I put it to have it there as a statement to others that I love Jesus. So I want to, for you to take it as a reminder. I rule that commitment. So whenever you're ready, they're here up front.